Hi, my name is Alex Mandrika, and today I want to talk about zero-sum games, what it means for game design, what they're good for, their limitations, but also their alternatives. For starters, zero-sum is a term of game theory that describes a situation when the gain of one participant is equal to the loss of all the others. A very simple example is when someone gives you money, when its loss is exactly equal to what you've gained. Games with the zero-sum model are very common, and examples include poker and Monopoly, where players exchange money, but the overall pool remains constant. Chess is slightly different though, because pieces are destroyed as the game progresses. The evaluation of a player's position is done relative to the other, so if white loses a rook, his position is minus 5, while black is plus 5. So even though there's a loss on the board, the relative value is constant between the players. A zero-sum model is very adapted to determining a winner because every gain improves a player's chances. It's called the snowball effect and is very efficient for competitive play. But if an unwinnable game drags on for too long, like in Monopoly, it can create frustration. This is why you can see top chess players concede very early in games they know is lost in the long run. But if your players are not able to clearly see that, you need to ensure that the games end very quickly. One way to avoid stale games and to offer a chance of comeback are catch-up mechanics. They are very frequent in driving games, where the trailing player magically finds his engine boosted. In chess terms, it's exactly as if the leading player would be a plus 5, while the trailing one would be, say, minus 3. This is why I call it an inflationary model, because overall, the game economy has increased. That model is mainly used for the entertainment of the players, and it goes against competition because it limits the advantage the leader fairly earned. The ELO ranking system used in chess is zero-sum, because the points earned by the winner are equal to those lost by the loser. On the other hand, it is frequent even in competitive games like World of Warcraft and Call of Duty to reward the loser player with some progression XP. ELO uses zero-sum to accurately determine the player's skills, while an inflationary model is great to reward participation. So if zero-sum and inflationary models are good at different things, maybe you'll ask,
¿Por qué no las dos?
In Hearthstone, the first part of the ladder is inflationary, as you gain more rank than you lose because of a winning streak bonus. Then in Legend, it switches to a zero sum, just like ELO. So here you have an example of a hybrid system that rewards and gives motivation to both competitive players and more casual ones. To summarize, I would say that zero sum models are best suited for competition, while inflationary models are great to promote participation. If you want more details on game theory for game design, I will link to one of my articles at the end of the video. That's it for today, and as we pass 600 subscribers, I'd like to thank you for your support. So if you have a topic or a question you want me to address, just drop a comment in the box below, and I'll do my best to do a video about it. Thank you very much.